Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti per il Festival Food and Science di Mantova. Questa mattina siamo con Eva Condorosi, che è una studiosa ungherese che ha compiuto gli studi universitari sia in Ungheria che in Germania, Max Planck, e al Centre National de Recherche Scientifique in Francia. Ora ha avuto una serie di incarichi ed è nel Consiglio Scientifico dell'Unione Europea e anche nel Consiglio Scientifico dell'ERC, coordinatrice delle scienze della vita. Il suo lavoro principale è l'argomento di cui parleremo in questo nostro incontro, sono le interazioni tra le piante in generale e i batteri che costituiscono la rizosfera, cioè la popolazione di batteri che sta attorno alle radici. Potrebbe sembrare una cosa piuttosto esoterica, ma è estremamente importante e fondamentale per lo studio dell'agricoltura, anche per il futuro dell'agricoltura. Cominciamo con una domanda molto semplice, poi continueremo con altre domande per cercare di approfondire il campo di studio della dottoressa Condorosi. Professor Condorosi, could you introduce us to the main character of your work, of your field of study?
My research field is symbiotic nitrogen fixation, and the major player of these interactions are legume plants like alfalfa, pea, beans, soybean, just to mention a few ones, and rhizobium soil bacteria. The interaction between the plant and the rhizobia leads to the formation of root nodules, and within these new symbiotic organs, the bacteria can convert the atmospheric nitrogen to ammonia and supply the plant with the fixed nitrogen. So this means that plants can live without external nitrogen source and this satisfies all their needs. So this is the symbiotic nitrogen fixation.
Okay, could we classify this kind of interaction as a obligatory symbiosis, meaning that neither bacteria nor plant can live without the other one, the other character of the play, let's say?
No, this is not an obligatory symbiosis. So both the plants and the rhizobia can live independently in the soil. However, if there is nitrogen starvation for the plant, then the plant initiate the symbiosis because this gives an advantage for the plant to live with nitrogen fixation. So this is not obligatory. But we are at the developmental stage and maybe we see an evolution. And one can imagine that within a few million years, maybe this symbiosis will be maintained, and the bacteria within the plant cells look like organelles. So maybe we are going to this developmental stage when rhizobia will fix nitrogen within these plant cells. But this will take millions of years, maybe.
Yes, it's time for the evolution to act, let's say. I mean,
Yeah, because.
we're at the beginning of the stage of more strict, let's say, collaboration between plants and bacteria, maybe. Anyway, what other kind of material they exchange, bacteria and what kind of material they exchange?
The ultimate goal is the symbiosis is providing ammonia for the plants, and in return, the plant supplies the bacteria with carbon sources and energy. So, but this is the major exchange or the final exchange. But before that, there are a lot of molecular communication between the plant and the bacteria, and this involves very different molecules.
So it's a kind of, let's say, a dialogue between plants and
Dialogue.
bacteria.
This is molecular dialogue between the plant and the bacterium all along the symbiosis from the beginning, the first recognition in the soil until the fixation stage in the nodule.
So it's not a normal bacteria. I mean, they know each other, plants and bacteria. There's a special kind of bacteria to collaborate with the plants.
Yeah, actually, this collaboration is induced by the plants. So when the plants do not have enough nitrogen in the soil, they start to secrete from the root flavonoids or isoflavonoids molecules. This goes into the rhizosphere. There are many, many bacteria and microbes there, and they have to find their rhizobium partners. So these flavonoids will only be recognized by the rhizobium partner, which will lead to activation of bacterial genes which will be involved in the synthesis of a bacterial signal molecules. These are the NOT factors. These are lipoketooligosaccharide molecules, which can have specific modification on the sugar backbone, and this gives a host specificity. So certain substitution will be recognized only by, let's say, alfalfa, and other substitution maybe by bean or by other legumes. So this gives a host specific interaction. And these NOT factors are recognized by specific receptors on the host plants, and this is required for induction, a signal transduction pathway, which is required both for the infection process and also for development of the nodules.
Yeah.
This is the very first interaction, but let's say for the invasion to have it really effective, we need also components of the bacterial surface like exopolysaccharides and lipopolysaccharides. So this also contribute to this infection process.
So that means that in bacteria and plant there are genes specific for signaling, let's say, produce this kind of molecule in order to induce the let's say the bacteria to come to the plant and try to collaborate with them. I mean, it's just, as we said before, it's a beginning of an evolution. I mean, it's not just a chance encounter between plants and bacteria.
Absolutely.
Do you know how old or widespread is this relationship between plants and bacteria?
Yeah, it started about 65 million years ago. And we have even from this time some fossil nodules or nodule-like structures. This is restricted to certain clades of the plants. And it seems
and
that
just,
this...
Just for clades, you mean the group of plants?
Group of plants, yeah. Certain, yeah. So in the dicot plants, there are four... groups of plants which can form endosymbiosis and nodule development. But it started at different times, so it seems that there are multiple origin of this endosymbiosis and nodule development, and this started at different time points, so some of them earlier, some of them later.
And so the same bacteria that collaborate with various plants, I mean, is it widespread just in dicot or in all the other plants?
No. So this is just for four groups of plants. So these are the Fabales, Fagales, Cucurbitales, and Rosales plants.
Okay. Is there some kind of fungi intervening in this kind of collaboration, just plants and bacteria? Because, you know, of course, that there are many, relationship between plants and fungi too, in mycorrhizae and so forth and so on. Do they come into play, all the fungi?
Yeah, this is the most ancient symbiosis which occurred between plants and this antimicrobial symbiosis. And this was very important when the land plants appeared on the world because the soils were very infertile, and the interaction with the fungi and symbiosis helped the uptake of water, phosphate, nitrate, so all kind of solution, the inorganic material. So that was very, very important. And you find it almost in all plants, almost in all land plants. And the rhizobium legume symbiosis developed much later, because the first one is dated for about 450 million years ago, and symbiosis started 65 million years ago. So this is much younger. But it seems that the endosymbiosis of the fungi and the bacteria evolved or using the same machinery. So some genes are also conserved and maybe adopted from the mycorrhizal symbiosis to the rhizobium legume symbiosis. So even the signal molecules, the first signals, the MYC factors and the NOT factors are quite similar in chemical nature. However, they are recognized by different receptors, but after there is a common symbiotic signaling pathway where the genes are common. And these are present practically almost in all plants. But then to go for nodule development or symbiosis, this requires other genes and other machinery.
So maybe there's been a switch between fungi and bacteria in signaling between plants and on the other, the hosts, let's say.
Actually, these two symbioses can live together. The mycorrhizal symbiosis can also help the rhizobium symbiosis and nitrogen fixation. So actually, this is really a benefit for the plants to have both kinds of symbiosis. The only problem that the rhizobium legume symbiosis is really restricted to the legume plants.
Ah, okay, fine. And could you just summarize how important is your work in for the agriculture? For the cultivation of leguminosae.
Yeah, if you see the growing human population, we need really a huge increase in agricultural production. Actually, from the beginning of the last century, I think from 1913, the agricultural production increased enormously due to the Haber-Bosch chemical synthesis of ammonia from airborne nitrogen. So this was really an explosion in the evolution in the human population. So the population increased from 1.7 billion up to 7.7 billion by now, and it will increase maybe further. However, this use of chemical fertilizers in the agriculture has also a lot of negative effects. So it pollutes the soil, the waters, air, and also the ecosystems. And it has really a lot of negative effect. And if we look that the production of the nitrogen fertilizers represent 2% of the global energy consumptions, this is really enormous, and certainly we have to decrease this one in the future. The biological nitrogen fixation does not have this kind of negative effects, and actually, if we increase biological nitrogen fixation, we can decrease the use of nitrogen fertilizers, and also this is less harmful for the environment. So really the objective is to increase nitrogen fertilizer, biological nitrogen fixation instead of using nitrogen fertilizers. We have to know, however, if we have a lot of nitrate in the soil, then biological nitrogen fixation will not work effectively. But there are continents like Africa where there was little use of nitrogen fertilizers. And in Africa, for example, using biofuel fertilizers, inoculum of rhizobium strains or coating seeds already with rhizobium can increase really tremendously the agricultural productivity. So we can work on this process.
But is it possible to switch from just a small group of plants to any other crop, let's say, to use this kind of relationship in, I don't know, wheat, maize, or so forth?
Yeah, this is the dream of the scientist, actually, but there are different ways. So we can use the rhizobium legume symbiosis example, but in this case, we have to make a nodule formation on these plants because the bacterial nitrogenase enzyme is extremely sensitive for the oxygen, and the nodule structure can provide a micro environment where there are low level of oxygen, and this is absolutely needed for the work, the functioning of the nitrogenase. So this can be maybe done. It's a question what kind of bacteria strain one would use, whether it would use rhizobium or one can use the bacteria which are already living in association or maybe an endophytic relationship with these plants. We have to identify, and we know for some strains, which is the minimal genetic information, what we have to include maybe into another bacterium strains to make nitrogen fixation and even nodule formation. So if we can use this kind of combination, maybe even nodulation and nitrogen fixation will be possible. Another way to engineer and incorporate the nitrogen fixation genes directly in plants. Of course, here we have again the problem of the oxygen protection. And also for the nitrogen fixation, one needs a lot of energy and reducing power. But there are already very advanced studies that nitrogen was introduced in mitochondria, and also it can be introduced plastids, which makes, hopefully, that maybe we can have this kind of nitrogen fixing plants. Yeah. Another way that we know that maize can have association with other nitrogen-fixing bacteria. For example, Azospirillum. This is not an intracellular symbiosis. This is an association. But we can also improve this association and make more efficient biological nitrogen fixation. So even if you are coating maize seeds, for example, with Azospirillum, it can satisfy 30 to 80% of the nitrogen need of the plant. So there are ways what can be done by engineering the plants, also how we are doing the agricultural management and let's say using fertilizers when they are used together with the biological inoculums. So it can improve really the capacity of the agricultural production.
So it's possible to, let's say, to tweak the genes of the plants and the bacteria in order to increase the, to let's say, to better the relationship and maybe to increase the number of plants in which this relationship is done.
Yeah, this is a long-term process, and this is not as simple as we thought many years ago. So this is very, very complex, but I think we are on the way, and also the technology improved so much that it will be feasible. It will not be tomorrow, but hopefully it will be in the coming 20 years, 30 years, maybe we have really achieved this goal.
I mean, do we need really high technological advanced technology, let's say, sorry for the repetition, in order to have this kind of introduction of genes in bacteria? Or you think in maybe 10 years, 20 years, would be possible to have this kind of technology widespread in even in poor country where maybe technology is not so advanced?
I think if we can generate this kind of plants afterwards, spreading the seeds will not be a problem. But we have to select a few crop plants which are really very important, like wheat, maize, rice, and try to make these plants somehow nitrogen fixers. And then it can be propagated. I think not. You have to do it maybe once, selecting the best combinations, and when it's really working, then you can send the seeds everywhere. So this is not by country that you have to develop this one. You develop in global, in the world, by the knowledge of all scientists who exist in the field, and then you can use this knowledge and the seeds or the plants for propagation.
Yeah. Could we call it a second or third green revolution, this kind of approach to the agriculture?
I think so. This would be really a great revolution, and if we can really diminish or reduce tremendously the use of nitrogen fertilizers, it will help the health of our earth, because we're really polluting a lot, and this is not discussed so much, how pollution is, how much pollution is generated by chemical nitrogen fixation, the chemical nitrogen fertilizers.
Could you, since it's not very much discussed, could you just give us a little introduction of the kind of consequences of nitrogen nitrogen pollution, and maybe phosphorus pollution, something like that? Could you tell us just a little bit what happens to the environment when there's too much nitrogen and not the nitrogen is not uptaken by the plants?
Yeah, actually, the plants use only a fraction of the nitrogen fertilizers. Some estimations said that only half, 50%, others they said that maybe 30% of the fertilizers remain in the soil. And this nitrogen nitrate will go into the waters. This can change the population in the waters. This is also, let's say, you will have more algae, you will have less other animals. So this will change the biological balance of the environment, and this is not good for the environment. Also, the biodiversity is very much decreased by this one, because certain, let's say, algae can overpopulate certain habitats and not others. But this is only the water. We know also that you cannot drink water if you have nitrate in it, so it's very dangerous for our health as well. There are also a lot of poisonous nitrogen in the air, and these are various nitrogen oxide derivatives. And there was an estimation that, let's say, just in Europe, maybe the life of the human population decreases 6 months by the presence of these nitrogen oxide derivatives. So this is also very dangerous. If we are just looking at the production of the nitrogen fertilizers requires a lot of fossil fuels and also the release of carbon dioxide. So that really a tremendous danger for the climate and for our earth. So we really have to do something to improve biological nitrogen fixation, to extend the plants which can utilize biological nitrogen fixation, and reduce as much as possible the use of the nitrogen fertilizers.
Now, how is let's say the relationship between you and the crop production, I mean the agriculture world? Now, do you have an exchange of ideas, or they're just stuck to their own way of doing crops?
Actually, I am not direct contact, and I am not working directly on these questions, but there are many scientific consortium who are doing this one, and they have really contact also with the maize producers, and there is a dialogue. There is also this Bill Gates Foundation, which supports also the work, how you can increase crop production in Africa, how to enhance nitrogen fixation. So they are really in contact with the farmers, also discussing how to make cultivation of plants, how to manage the agricultural procedures to have it in an optimal way. So myself, I am not involved in that one. My interest is more what we can gain from the symbiosis. I am working on the dialogue of the bacteria and the plants in a later stage nowadays, and to see how the plant can convert the bacteria for a higher nitrogen fixer state. And this involves hundreds of small peptides which are produced by the plants, and they are present only in these symbiotic cells. And this is really an unexplored source of many new biological activities. So we found that many of these peptides can inhibit bacterial cell division, and some of them are very good candidates as new antimicrobial agents. And we developed from this natural plant peptide derivatives, which are at least as good as the third generation of antibiotics, and they do not have toxicity on human cells. And we know that many antibiotics have many diverse effects which are not very good for us. And this plant-derived antimicrobials can kill also the most difficult bacteria, human pathogens, bacteria, as well as fungi. So in this sense, this is another way what we can learn and exploit from the biological nitrogen fixation.
One last question. Now you're in the scientific advisor committee as a chief scientific advisor of the EU. How will be your job? I mean, your duty with the EU.
Actually, this scientific advice mechanism was created by the European Commission in 2015 during the Horizon 2020. It is composed by the group chief scientific advisors. There are seven members, and they are representing different scientific domains, but also different age groups and gender, and as well as geographical distribution. So there are topics which are urgently needed for policy advice. So either the European Commission ask advice on certain topics, or even our group can propose certain topics, and we are working together with the SAPEA. This is Science Advice for Policy by European Academies. So this is really a huge amount of knowledge what we can get from this SAPEA consortium, because they are making the evidence review reports, and this is summing up the most relevant evidence-based information, and also gives an analysis. And based on that one, we can give scientific advice for the Commission, who can make afterwards legislation or some recommendations on different in different aspects and thematics. So myself, I started to work in this group in May, and I am now involved in a working group which is trying to give an opinion or preparing an opinion paper on how to handle and manage pandemics, including the COVID and any other future pandemics, how to be prepared for that one, how to manage it, how to come out from this one. And then this will continue in with the general crisis management, which can involve not only pandemics, but also natural crises or economic crisis, and how we can reshift even the existing system to a new one, and how we can come out on the best way from this kind of crisis. So this is the present work.
See, I mean, it's a very tough job, as I say, because because the present system is, I think, is the basis of the crisis in COVID or of environmental crisis and so forth and so on. So it will be a very tough job for you to try to suggest how to change this kind of approach to maybe economical system and natural one. Thank you very much for your collaboration. Thank you very much, and best wishes for your work. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you very much. And I wish you an excellent festival, the Food and Science Festival. And I am really sorry that I cannot be there in person, because I would have loved to be there.
Thank you again.